things are only getting better as we kick off season 3 of Tuned In SA.
Good fun.
I'll be showing you some awesome local car talent as I find some of the hottest custom rides in SA. And we give you a peek at what's happening internationally as each week we take a look at what was on show at some of the biggest tuning events in the world. We have a new team member this year, Jade Gutzeit, a car and a bike fanatic who has definitely earned his racing stripes. He's going to be testing some monster cars out at Desi Raceway. And this boy has some serious skills on the track. We also have a new project this season where one lucky viewer will have his car completely made over. This week, we're going to be checking out some of the entries before we make the big winner announcement next week. Plenty coming your way this season, it is going to be mad. And what better way to start than with a BMW M3.
Hey guys, my name is Jade Gutzeit. I've been involved in motorsport for about 20 years now. First in off-road motorbikes and enduros, and then for the last 10 years, dabbling in a whole lot of car racing, everything from hill climbs to West Bank V8s, and I retired officially from motorbikes in 2012. And just been enjoying the life since then. I'll be hosting the performance side of Tune In SA, hopefully giving you guys a bit of insight into South Africa's best tuned cars. And let's kick the season off with this. This is a BMW E46 M3. In my mind, one of the most iconic M3s, last of the straight sixes. And as we always do, let's start off with what's under the bonnet. So the car starts off as a naturally aspirated 3.2 litre straight six engine. To get the type of horsepower that the guys need out of it, they need to up it to 3.4 litre and obviously force it with air. To do that, they use a Vortex supercharger, which rams air into the engine, but when it does this, all the parts get under big strain, so they have to put forged pistons and special conrods and also a stud kit, which holds everything together. Often with high boost, you get a lot of detonation, so Rob Green's chosen to run a water methanol injection system that helps the car cool down under high boost. And then to top it all off, they've added a six fog and nitrous system as if it wasn't enough. Also installed are fully adjustable coilover suspension, aftermarket of course, front and back. The AC Snitzer strut brace, the car's got anti-roll bars front and rear, Vorsteiner bonnet and bumper. Just I think the bonnet and the bumper are about 100 grand. And then let's take a look at these beautiful wheels. ...20-inch of course, as big as possible. They've been widened. The AP strap drive brakes, just the front rotors are 385 mils wide, which is almost the same size as a lot of small cars' wheels. The AP brakes are 6 pots at the front and 4 pots at the rear. Strap drive is a system that AP used to enable the disc to float a lot more, and I suppose the driver to get a lot better feel with his feet. The bodywork was widened, but if you look at the car, you wouldn't even say it. It looks pretty standard, and which is so cool for this car, because even though it's 30 or 40 mils wider, it still looks like a normal street car. In the boot, we've got the tank for the methanol injection, the fire extinguisher in case the car blows up, and of course the NOS bottle, which has its own little blanket, and it's got the strut brace in the back as well. I think one of the things that I don't like on the car is the Schnitzer wing that was fitted. Maybe it pushes it over the edge a little bit, and not that many mods on the interior, but let's have a look at it anyway. So as you come around to the front of the car and open the door, the first thing you see is the Jungle Gym roll cage. Inside the car is pretty much a standard M3. They've kept it, all the mods, nice and subtle and sort of out of the view. It's got a nice carbon fiber molded AFR gauge. It's got backup systems here for the air fuel ratio mixture as well. These three buttons is for the NOS system. The car's been fitted with adjustable dry carbon Sparco racing seats. Over here we have a button where if the car bursts into flames, I can push, and a nozzle here, a nozzle under the bonnet, and a nozzle in the boot sprays the fire extinguisher fluid, if you want to call it, out on me, so at least I can survive. So I suppose there's only one thing left to do, and that's to start this baby up and take it onto the track and see what it can do. The nice thing about a supercharged car versus a turbocharged car is that the power is pretty much instantaneous. As soon as you put your foot down, there's horsepower there. This car particularly ranges between 300 and 600 horsepower, depending on what the boosters that you choose to run at. Obviously the cars can't run at full boost all the time, so you need to look after the engine. The anti-roll bars, you can feel straight away, the car is nice and stiff, it doesn't roll, and it's quite bumpy obviously on a track, but that's what the coil-up suspension is there for. If you want to drive it on the road, you can make the suspension softer, and I think you can get the car to perform beautifully on road and on track. You can feel all the ABS is really working and still kicking in. Obviously all that stuff was left in because the car is still a road car. Obviously the traction control and everything else seems to be kicking in all the time. I'm tired of the computers telling me what to do. Let's switch off the traction control and sport button and see what this car can do. When you turn the buttons off and let your foot do the deciding, it makes car driving so much more fun. As you can hear, the dump valve's very noisy in the car. It's something that I think is maybe too noisy. I think personally they could have run it down in a pipe down to the ground, you know, it'd be a lot less noisy and a lot more drivable, especially on the road. When you drive this car on the road and you take your foot off the accelerator, the cars just disperse, you know, they get so scared that they think a Boeing is landing next to them. Good fun. So in closing, I think a great car at home on the track and on the road. A little bit noisy for my liking, but I think money well spent. The owner can be proud of all the money he's put into it, every aspect of it, and I wouldn't mind having it in my garage.
Some crazy driving there by Jade. Now guys, please remember, don't try and put your dad's Corolla sideways on your way to school. Jade's been doing this for years. He's a professional, so let's leave it to him. After the break, we check out some of the entries we've received for our Tuned in SA competition, and we'll also be answering your tuning questions.
And there are many ways of tuning cars and improving cars without causing any damage to the car.
So late last year, we told you we are looking for a good car to make awesome, and we received hundreds and hundreds of entries. Sadly, there can be only one winner, but here are some of the more impressive entries we've received.
Neil Quantrill submitted his 1964 Volkswagen Beetle, affectionately called Herbie, and I'm sure you can see why. Herbie's looking pretty good, and I'm not sure we want to tamper with what's going on over here, Neil, so I don't know, we'll see. Garth Stradom submitted his 2004 Subaru Impreza 2.5 RS. She is Garth's daily drive and already has a unit chip installed. He doesn't want her drop, but would like her to be made over. She's looking pretty good there, Garth, and in good condition too. Definitely a nice contender, this one. Lynn Mahlakhaume from Soweto also entered our tuned competition. Here is his 2006 Fiat Palio. Ish, Lynn, not really the best picture, but I guess at least you're keeping her clean, you know. At only 21, we can see that you are a true petrolhead who truly loves his first ride. Amir McKenzie submitted his 2006 BMW M6. Now, I guess the motto fits very well here. You can never have enough power. This M6 is in truly pristine condition and already delivers a hefty helping of kilowatts, but Amir wants more. They all want more! Lwando Kuli sent in this entry. This is his Ford Focus 1.8 SI 5 door. There are tons of modifications and custom items that you can use on your Ford Focus. I mean, just go to any track day and you'll see plenty of unique custom Focuses out there. So Lwando, if you don't get chosen, then head to your closest and reliable tuning house and get some quotes on some, you know, custom bits and pieces. Franz Malete from Sosha sent us this picture of his Toyota Taz 1.3. Now, we all know Toyotas are nice to work on and Tazes are not exempt from that. There are a few things that Franz could do here. I mean, even some awesome stickers on your gorgeous paintwork, a nice set of rims, and they don't have to even cost you a pretty penny. You just need to shop around for shoes that your car wants to wear. Manny Grobler entered his Opel Monza. That's right, you heard it, a 1993 Monza. These are actually pretty good cars to work on, and it seems like this one is in pretty good shape, although Manny did say the previous owner did not look after it. Morgan Governor entered his 2012 VW Polo Vivo Blula. Now you can see he likes a bit of custom work as he's already started changing things here and there and adding personal touches. Plenty of polos out there, so being unique as a petrol head must be so difficult, but it's a definite must. This is just a few of the hundreds of entries we received, so a big thanks to all of you for taking the time to submit your car, and please do not stop.
Next week, we'll be revealing the winner, so don't miss that. You guys have been asking a lot of questions, and it's awesome, so keep them coming. Each week, we're going to try and answer as many as possible. And this week, Justin gets to grips with the basics of tuning.
I have a BMW 120D 2005 model. I just want to find out, will tuning hurt my car?
Tuning shouldn't hurt your car. There are a couple of critical questions to that and critical answers. Tuning will hurt your car if it's not done properly or not done by an expert workshop. Okay, so that's probably the first place to start. Research who you're going to take the car to. Make sure that they've got a track history. Make sure that they've got references of cars that they've done and the improvement that's done, that they're not experimenting on your car. When you're dealing with reputable people, then they'll have references, they'll have jobs that they've done to be able to show you the improvements that they can make. And there are many ways of tuning cars and improving cars without causing any damage to the car, okay, as long as they're done properly.
Hi, my name's Dine. I'm here with my brother Diversion, and we're here with his Polo 5 GTI. My question for you guys is, if he tuned his car, would it affect the warranty? And if so, would the dealership know?
In regards to tuning and warranties, tuning does affect a warranty. Motor manufacturers do not want you tuning your car because they need to cover themselves against their warranty claims. And if you have a warranty claim, in some circumstances, it can be caused from tuning, and in other circumstances it can't be caused. The problem is that generally, if they find that you've tuned your car, they will penalize you against your warranty.
If you read the warranty that any manufacturer gives on their new vehicles, tuning will affect that. The only thing that you can do on a vehicle that's warranted and you don't want to affect any tuning would be the air filter, because there you're actually upgrading on what the standard vehicle is supplied with, okay? There are some manufacturers that understand that doing an exhaust system or doing software on the vehicle, if it's done properly, will not do any damage to the vehicle. So you actually get some manufacturers that send vehicles in to be done. But the unfortunate thing is there's no set standard that controls when things are not done properly. So when guys take vehicles to unreputable workshops and then damage is caused, that can cause that your warranty will be cancelled. But you need to check nicely with the guys that are supplying the warranty, what their warranty entails and what they'll cover.
A pimped out RSI Turbo is coming your way after the break, and we bring you the hottest design concepts from the halls of the Essen Motor Show. Now, if you look closely, that's a TT, a Toyota Taz. Or is it? Actually, it's not. But back in 1992, this is the legendary Toyota Conquest RSI. Now this is Brandon, the owner of this lovely, legendary Toyota Conquest RSI. Buddy, tell us, where did it all start for you, this particular car?
5 years ago, Deon, my dad bought me this car, right, when I was in matric. And from then, you know what, it one thing led to another. Firstly, my passion was sound. And then I led to rims, and then I managed to find a body kit, and then 5 years later, and I got the car to what I'm looking to now.
Now, you got the car in clean condition. Have you started with painting on the car first before you went to styling it and modifying it?
Not really. Firstly, like every teenager, every young guy who has a car doesn't wait too long to get it on the road. I mean, my first instinct was just to put rims in a car and make sure it's on the road.
You only got 17-inch. I mean, most guys go 19s nowadays. What happened to that?
I mean, okay, the town I live in, the roads are pretty bad. I mean, 17-inch is as close as I was going to go to get 19-inch. I mean, everywhere I go with the sound, with the car's heavy cheese, it's always touching and scraping somewhere.
Yeah. Now, talk about scraping, you do have an extremely hot body kit. You also told me you got it by default in a store.
Yeah, default in the shop. I mean, I went there one day and then I browsed in the shop and I saw this body kit. And then, you know what, I never asked him about the cash. So the next day I phoned the guys up, you know what, I need this body kit. They didn't even know they had it in the shop with them.
Yeah.
And then, you know what, I came there and I had to show them, hey, there's a kit I'm looking for. They're saying, they didn't know they had it in the shop. Yeah. And it's one of a kind. I never seen anyone like before.
The 17-inch racing hard narrow and wide rims really complements this sleek DTM body kit, which was purchased from AutoStyle Gateway. At the cost of only $3,000, it goes to show it doesn't cost a lot of money to make a major transformation on your car. The intercooler and oil cooler had to be modified to fit just behind the front bumper. Installation done by VNR panel beaters. Now the kit is amazing. The car's rear is also amazing. Tell us about the sound that you got in your car.
The sound, that's my passion, the sound. I mean, firstly, every teenager goes through their own setups, goes through every different subwoofer, every different amplifier. For me, this is my end product. I went with Earthquake. I mean, I love Earthquake. It's an old brand. And you know what? I have 215-inch Earthquake in the car. It takes up the whole boot. I mean, if you open the boot, it doesn't even look like the boot will close. I mean, I'm happy with the sound in the car. But to me, there's always room for improvement.
Aside from the 2x15-inch DBXI Earthquake subwoofers, Brandon's complete sound install by Elite Car Customs comprises of a PH10000 monoblock amp for the subs, a PH2200 four-channel amp for the splits, two sets of VTEC splits on the front and back doors, Camtek doubled-in player, custom box and amp rack. All this totaling a whopping 30,000 Rand,
Yeah, this boy is really passionate about his sound.
Okay, now obviously with good sound is great, but obviously you need more performance now because the car is heavy.
Yeah, exactly.
tell us through the modification.
Oh, the modification I've done to the car is turbo. That's the one route that
turbo, but you still kept the 1.6 engine.
I still kept the 1.6 engine. I just did the internals in the engine, newer pistons, I did the engine complete, I have a dictator management system, turbo smart products, I have a custom built 3T4 turbo in the car. I have nitrous running on the car, Deon. I mean, it gets me A to B, but it also carries the extra weight to the sound. So I'm happy with the performance. It's doing about 210 kilowatts on the wheels. I mean, it's not built for drag racing, but on the dyno, it'll do pretty well.
Okay, so for show purposes, it does deliver.
Yeah, definitely, Deon. Okay.
Along with the nitrous, Brandon has also opted to install a nitrous purge system. Purging is done to allow a fresh supply of nitrous at the flick of a switch. So, it doesn't just look cool, it actually helps with the performance of the car. Brandon purchased a kit for only 1,500 Rand and did the installation himself.
Now, with the interior of the car, I see the car is very neat. It has a nice doubled end there. Obviously, we are moving towards a digital age, so how do you combat that with your car sound?
I had an idea before of putting mixers in my car. I wanted to put a mixer in my car, like DJ tables. I mean, I'm sure you're an expert in that. I was going to make a setup in my car.
Yeah, I got a mixer there.
Exactly. I mean, I was going to put a mixer in my car and have that with more extra TVs in my car. I mean, everything now is touchscreen. Yeah. I mean, even though I love my sound, but I also want to look very, very classy.
Well, buddy, let me tell you, from all the cars I've seen, 1992 Toyota Conquest RSR, I've never seen anything as amazing and classy and elegant at the same time. So well done on making your car look super hot.
Thanks, Deon. I much appreciate it. I mean, it took me a while to get there. It's just that there's only one problem, that there's always something more to do.
Just like how Brandon's car is customized and looking fly, next week we'll have more cars just like this on the show. Local is lekker, no doubt. But here on Tuned, we also like to check out what is going on across the pond. And this week, we'll look at some of the latest design concepts at one of the biggest tuning shows in the world. Check it out.
Local trends are often influenced by what's happening on the international scene. And there are a few big name tuning shows around the world, Germany's Essen Motor Show being one of them. And this week, we bring you some of the more customized rides. This VW Golf 1 Cabrio must be owned by a true coffee addict, as the trim is entirely coated in coffee beans. The car is appropriately painted in metallic brown with the rear suspension assembly, the drive shafts, and the wishbones in beige. This Polaris Slingshot is an authentic fun car, originally from the USA, and went on sale in Germany about a month ago. It boasts 175 PS, a top speed of 220 km per hour, and accelerates from 0 to 100 in 5.6 seconds. Price tag is just under 30,000 euros or 756,000 rand. The Splinter is quite a unique machine. It looks like a Lamborghini, but it's made entirely of wood. Its 7-litre Chevrolet LS7 V8 engine delivers 680 PS. Joe Harmon from the USA started the project while he was still studying back in 2007.
So my whole life I wanted to design and build my own car, and this was my opportunity to do that. Wood has a better strength to weight ratio than steel and aluminum, so we thought it would make a really interesting challenge to build an entire car out of wood.
Here's another good-looking car. It's stationed in the Tuning Experience Hall and is an Audi S4 Cabrio in a rather special leather look. Rat tuning or styling is already well known from the world of motorsport, but the most radical BMW of all exclusively debuted at the Essen Motor Show. H&R and Mike Burrows present the Rusty Slammington. Based on a burnt-out BMW 535i, this racing monster boasts 500 horsepower. Plenty more happening, so tune in next week for a peek at what's happening across the oceans.
We'll have more for you next week. Not to mention some rotary magic with the RX-7.
This heating position is a little bit difficult to get used to, but you know, it's a rotary engine being so radically different to a normal engine that it actually feels pretty the same, you know, when you drive the car.
And a car that may have come straight from the movies. Make sure you don't miss out. Catch you next week.
SAS Presents is Travel, proudly sponsored by iGo Travel, the easiest way to travel today.